This is Chicho. Welcome to my channel. Now, what I'd like to do in this video is continue our conversation we had regarding economics from the previous video. In the previous video, what we did was we talked about disruptive innovation and how new technology, new ways of doing things can play out in this scene, right? Which is basically one of the foundations of our current economic system, right? Our current economic system is one of the foundations is based on disruptive innovation, where basically new technology coming onto the scene and challenging old technology and how our society grows with new innovations and new ways of doing things and new mindsets, right? The other foundation of our present economic system is based on growth. It's all about growth, 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 okay? And what we're gonna do is take a look at a formula, which is basically an interest rate formula, compound interest rate, if you wanna think about it. And if you've done high school mathematics, you would have encountered this in grade 10 or grade 11. In grade 10, it's the basic equations that they give you. In grade 11, in my part of the world anyway, they get into more complicated questions. So we're gonna start off with that. And what we're gonna do is we're gonna look at different growth rates. And we're going to create a table, and then we're going to create a graph, a visual. And that'll give us a pretty good idea of how growth comes into play. Okay, and we'll talk a little bit about a few different things. The growth rate sort of tells us about our economy and how the system is laid out. Okay, now, one of the first formulas, and we're going to look at the formula first, okay? One of the formulas that you would have encountered if you've done high school math would be basically it's the growth rate formula, which is the formula that they give you is this. Let's make sure we can get this on the map. A is equal to P 1 plus R over N to the power of NT. Now, if you've done any level of high school math in grade 10 or 11, you would have seen this, okay? And these are all just variables, things that we can plug in numbers for, depending on the situation that we have, right? T is your time in years. In years, and this is T, okay? N is a number of compounding periods. Right, so N equals number compound periods. Okay, for example, what that means is if you're getting interest paid to you once per year, then N is one. If you're getting paid interest monthly per year, then N becomes 12. If you're getting paid quarterly, then it becomes 4. If you're getting paid daily, then N becomes 365, okay? So it's basically the number of times per year that interest is being calculated and deposited into your account, okay? R is your growth rate, okay? R is your rate of growth. Rate of growth or your interest rate, right? Okay, your interest rate, what the interest is that you're getting paid. And if you're getting paid interest, then we have a plus here, right? P is your principal, what you started with, right? And we refer to that as P. And A is what you end up having, final, total. Those are basically what the variables represent. And what we're gonna do is we're gonna do a simple example. I'm gonna lay out a simple example. That way we'll do the calculations and we'll change the N, but we're gonna basically stick with a simple formula where we don't have an N. We're just getting paid interest per year because we're gonna look at an extended period of time, okay? So I hope this makes sense regarding the variables. So let's lay out a problem, okay? Let's assume we have the following. Let's do this in black. Let's see how this black comes out. Is that good? Oh yeah, nice and dark. Okay. It's morning right now, so we're getting reflections from the windows. Hopefully that's not interfering with the text that we're writing down, okay? So let's lay out a simple interest rate problem, okay? Let's assume we had $100, okay? $100, and we're gonna deposit that $100 into an account that pays us, let's say 5% interest, okay? So we're gonna deposit into an account that pays us 5% interest, and we want to find out how much money we have at the end of 1 year. Okay, 1 year. 1 year. And we're going to compound. We're going to be paid this interest once per year. So our N is going to be one. For one year, compounded annually. Compounded annually. Okay, that basically means once per year. The calculation is pretty simple. All we do, we put $100 for our P. We put 5% for our rate, but we can't put percentages in calculations and formulas. We have to convert 5% to a decimal. And 5% as a decimal is 0.05, right? You just divide 5 by 100. You can think about these two little dots here. For the percent symbol, that's two decimal places that you're moving things or dividing by 100. So all you do is just move the decimal place over 2. Our T is 1, and we're compounding annually, which is once per year, so our N is 1. So the calculation becomes A is equal to 100 times 1 plus 0.05 over 1 to the power of N is 1 times 1. Our time is 1, okay? If you do this calculation, you end up getting 100 times 0.05 divided by 1 is just 0.05. You put that together, you get 1.05 to the power of 1, which happens to be $105, okay? That's how much money we'll have at the end of 1 year if we take $100, deposit into an account that gives us 5% interest compounded annually for 1 year, which is a simple calculation which makes sense, right? Hopefully that comes out. We're not off the board. No, we're okay, I think. Okay. Now, what I want to show you is what happens if we change the N. Okay. Let's not compound annually. Let's compound daily. Okay. Compounded daily. Okay. Which basically means they're going to take 5% and divvy it up according to how much interest you're getting paid per day over a year, right? Which is basically taking 5% and dividing it by 365, right? So you're going to divide all that up, okay, over on a relative to daily basis, right, for 1 year. So what we're going to do is, I got my calculator here. So what we're going to do is, oops. What we're going to do is daily means 365. So we're going to change N and make it 365. So this guy becomes 365. And this guy, this N becomes 365 as well. Okay. 365. And our T is still 1. 1 year. Okay. Hopefully that's coming out. Might be a little bit too light. Let's see if it's, this is darker. Oh yeah, nice. We're gonna make this 365. Okay. So what happens now is, let me take this out. Our 100 is still gonna be 100, right? Because we haven't changed our principal, what we started with. This is going to become 1 plus 0.05 divided by 365. 0.05 divided by 365 is 0.0001369, and the whole thing to the power of 365, right? So what we got here is we're going to add 1 to that number, to this number. We're going to have 1.0, here, let me write this down, rewrite it, because we're tight on space. 0.0001 37 to the power of 365. Okay, so I'm going to take that to the power of 365. I'm going to get 1.0512. I'm going to multiply that by 100, and basically we end up having $105.13, right? So did that come up? I think so. That's on the board. So if we compound on a more regular basis, higher frequency, shorter wavelength, I guess you want to think about it as a wave, then we end up making 13 cents more per year if we get paid the same interest, but we're compounding on a more regular basis at a higher frequency, right? Now, this principle here, compounding interest, is an extremely important property of our economic system that really governs how our economic system works. And this principle kicks us into a concept called differential accumulation. And differential accumulation is something, I wrote down the names of the professors that came up with this principle, because I'm bad at pronouncing names. Their profession is political economy. So as we talked about in the politics video, you know, you have to talk about politics and economics in one breath, right? They're not disconnected. So the two people that have come up with this concept of differential accumulation, okay, are Jonathan Nitzan and Shimshon Beshler. And Shimshon Beshler is an Israeli professor, and Jonathan Nitzan is a Canadian Israeli professor. And their idea, their model states that accumulation of wealth, okay, accumulation of capital is relative to the averages, okay? And basically their principle, their idea relates to compound interest, because it states that basically the idea behind it is once you're ahead of the game, once you're beating the averages, then in the limit you'll acquire all wealth, right? And they consider wealth, accumulation of capital, as being accumulation of power, right? Which is pretty much what our present economic and political system is, right? The more wealth, the more capital you have, the more power you have, right? May it be with Citizens United or the way our political system works, right? How elections end up working, because if you look at elections, usually the person that spends the most gets elected, which is a weird concept, right? So what we're going to do, we're going to take a look at this system, this idea related to differential accumulation, and take a look at a visual of how this plays out and what this really means in our present economic system, okay? So I'm gonna remove these guys right now. I hope that, you know, it's a simple example. 12 cents extra per year may not seem like a lot, but if you do this to the limit, which is one of the powers of mathematics, okay? One of the things that math allows us to do is to model any system that we want and take a look at that system over an extended period of time. Take a look at it to the limit, right? Let it play out until the end and see what happens, right? And based on differential accumulation and compound interest, compound growth, right? Exponential growth, really, it's basically exponential growth, right? With exponential growth, compound growth, and differential accumulation, basically, if you take this concept to the limit, then in the limit, one organization, one company, one institution, one entity obtains everything because they're constantly growing at a faster rate. So if you're growing at the highest rate possible, you trump everyone else, right? In the limit, relative to everyone else, you obtain everything, okay? So what we're gonna do is we're gonna use the same formula, okay? But, so we're gonna go A is equal to P, 1 plus R over T. Because what we're gonna do, we're not gonna compound per year. We're just gonna look at a few years, right? Which has sort of has the same effect as compounding, right? But what I wanna do is make the formula simpler. So we took out the N here and we took out the N here. So we're gonna be paying out interest once per year, okay? And what we're gonna do, we're gonna look at, I sort of put a table here together, just did the calculations, and what we're going to do is translate this table here. And what we're going to do is look at a few different rates of growth, okay? And we're going to start off with $100. So what we're going to do is we're going to start off with $100, okay? And $100, and we're going to look at 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 different cases. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, right? And if we take this over here, you'll be able to see it. Perfect. Okay. So we're starting off with $100, and we're going to look at what happens to a rate of growth at 1 year, at 5 years, at 20 years, at 50 years, and at 100 years, right? What happens to our capital, right? What happens to our investment, to our money, right? Over a 100-year period, and we're going to look at those intervals, okay? So we're going to look at 1 year, we're going to look at 5 years, we're going to look at 20 years, we're going to look at 50 years, and we're going to look at 100 years, okay? If I had more space here, I would label these years and stuff like this, which is something you should do. And what we're going to do is we're going to set a baseline, okay? We're going to assume that $100 at the end of 100 years is not going to grow, right? So we're going to assume an interest rate, growth rate of zero. So we're going to call this one, we're going to call this one our base line, okay? At 0%. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to create a table. So basically what happens here is, let me write these down. So we have sort of a linear table going across, or 100, 100, 100, 100, and 100. Okay. So what we have, if we have $100 right now at 0.0, I guess, or 1 year, right? At the end of 100 years, we have no growth rate, we're still going to have $100. Okay. So let's create a table. Okay. 50 years, and we're going to go across as well. That way the numbers stand out better. Our eye can pick up the numbers. 0% and 100. Now this one went off a little bit too much. Let's because I do want the numbers to show up well. Right, so let's make this tighter. Okay, and we got this guy down here. Okay, easy peasy. Now, what we're gonna do is, first thing we're gonna look at is 2% growth. And the reason we're gonna look at 2% growth, because 2% growth is basically, for the Western world, is the rate of inflation that the central banks try to shoot for, okay? So basically, anywhere between 1.5, 1 to 3%. So we're gonna go with 2%. Basically, what that means is our governments are devaluing our money over time, and they're shooting to have an inflation rate of 2%. Okay, and basically what that means is your money is basically depreciating 2% per year, right? So if you had something that you could buy for $100 in the first, you know, at year zero, right? The next year, if you had a 2% rate of inflation across the board over everything, then that same item was going to cost you $102. Okay, so let's fill in these numbers here and see what happens if we start off with $100 at a 2% rate of inflation. Okay, and what happens with our money over 100 years, okay? And this is the formula we would be using. We would put in 100 here, we'd put in 2% here, which would be 0.02, and we'd take it to 1, 5, 20, 50, 100, and we put in those numbers in here, okay? And if we do that, this is what we end up with. At the end of 1 year, we end up having $102, right? If we're investing now, right? Or if something is costing you $100, you can think about it the same way. You can think about it as you taking money and putting into an account, right? $100 into an account that's paying you 2% interest per year. At the end of the first year, you get $102. At the end of 5 years, you would have $110. At the end of 20 years, you would have $149. At the end of 50 years, you would have $269. And at the end of 100 years, you would have $724, right? On the same level, if something you wanted to buy now costs you $100, a year from now, it would cost you $102. 5 years from now, it would cost you $110, $149, $269, $724 after 100 years, right? That's inflation. That's basically the concept of devaluing your money. Your money doesn't go as far, right? And anybody, if you buy groceries, if you buy food, you would have noticed that that's one thing that's happened over the last 10 years or so, 9 or 10 years or so. Food prices have gone through the roof, right? For me, I eat a lot of honey. And honey, 10 years ago, you know, one kilo bottle, right, jar, would cost me anywhere between $9 to $11, right? Or even less sometimes. Right now, 1 kilo jar of honey is costing anywhere between $16 to $20, right? That's almost doubling of price within 10 years. So we went, you know, if a jar of honey cost me $100, right? Or if I could buy 10 jars of honey for $100, 10 jars of honey 5 years later costing me $110, according to a rate of inflation of 2%, but it's costing me more than that in 9 years, right? Now, let's take a look at another interest rate. Let's take a look at an interest rate of 5%, okay? This one is at 5%. Hopefully these numbers are showing up. They're pretty small, but you know where we're putting them in, right? So interest rate of 5%. What we could do, erase these and put them together. Nah, it's okay, we'll do it this way. So 5%, and this is what you end up having, okay? if you invest $100 at 5%, after 1 year you have $105. And we did the calculation for this in the previous example, right? At the end of 1 year, you got 105%. At the end of 5 years, you have $128. At the end of 20 years, you got $265. So at the end of 20 years, at 5% interest, you have almost the same amount as if you were investing at 2% at the end of 50 years, right? Wow, huge difference. At the end of 50 years, you have $1,147. And at the end of 100 years, $100 is going to be $13,150, right? Wow. 2% to 5%, that's a little bit over twice as much, right? 2.5 times more. 2% to 5%. You're getting interest at 2.5 times what you're getting at 2% relative to 5%, right? But at the end of 100 years, the multiple here, actually let's do the multiple here. How many more times is that? 13,150 divided by 724. You have 18 times more money, right? So this multiple here is 18 times from here to here, right? From here to here, 1147 divided by 269 is 4.3 times. Okay. Over here, the multiple is decreasing, right? 265 divided by 149 is 1.8 times. And over here is not that much more. Is 1.2 times if we're rounding to one decimal place, right? So this concept of compound growth, it's not growth over an extended period of time, it's exponential growth, because if we're growing at any percent above zero, it's exponential growth, right? This exponential growth becomes more prevalent as time passes, right? So just imagine what it would be like 150 years from now, 200 years from now. You can do the calculations, right? And this is really important when you consider our present economic system, because we have institutions, right, that have been around, have existed for hundreds of years, right? Some of the largest institutions we have in our society are universities, right? There's universities that have been around for, I forget the numbers, right? 500, 600, 700, 8,000 years. I don't know. They're into the hundreds of years, right? So just imagine if those universities had $100 1,000 years ago, 800 years ago, and they took $100 and invested it in property or invested it into ventures, and they were getting a growth rate of whatever it was over an extended period of time, right? Then in 800 years, 500 years, wow, their investment is worth a lot of money, right? And if you take that into the context of you as a human being, your lifespan is limited. Our lifespan is limited. So when it comes to our present economic system, if we as individuals are competing with institutions that have a longer lifespan than we do, then in the long run, we all lose, right? Any institution, any corporation will end up owning everything, because what they end up making is huge compared to what we end up making, right? And this is only 5% growth. Let's take a look at 10% growth, right? What happens if we have here 10% growth? Okay. And just so you know, 2% is a rate of inflation. If you're making an investment and you're not beating the rate of inflation, in the long run you end up losing money, right? And that's where this one comes in. I did this one before we do the 10%, let's do this one. This one, let's assume we're losing 5% per year, right? Minus 5% per year, If you're losing 5% per year, then what you end up having is this. Okay, this becomes 95. After the first year, you lose 5%. You lost $5 out of 100. You got $95 left, right? At the end of 5 years, you got 77. At the end of 20 years, you got 35. At the end of 50 years, you have 8. And at the end of 100 years, your $100 is worth 50 cents, right? It's not worth anything, right? Especially if you consider at a rate of inflation of 2%, the item that you were able to buy for $100 at present was going to be worth $724, right? It's no longer worth 100. The 100 has lost its value, right? So the same item that you could buy now for $100, that 100 years from now is worth $724, if you're losing 5% per year, you're down at 50 cents. You probably can't even afford to pay to look at that item, right? So that's what happens if you don't beat the rate of inflation to a certain degree, right? If you're just making even money, right? If you're putting, you know, if you're taking your investment and just putting it under your couch, right? And 100 years you come back, you still your $100. Then if you wanted to buy the same item that you could 100 years ago, that item is now costing $724, right? That's 7.2 times more than what it costs you at present, right? So even if you're breaking even, your money's not worth anything, right? In the limit. Okay, and that's one thing all, you know, financial advisors or the first principle, one of the first principles, there's a handful of first principles when it comes to investing money, right? One of the first ones is preserve capital, right? Don't lose, because if you lose, then it takes more to come back up, right? If you lose, for example, if you have $100, right? If you lose 50%, then you're down at $50, right? But to come back to $100, you have to gain 100%, right? It's a weird concept. It's a weird concept, okay? And that's sort of how this growth works out here. And for, in general, if you're, you know, rate of inflation is 2%. You have to beat the rate of inflation in our present economic system. If we're, and we're only talking about money, okay, fiat currencies, okay, and certain other types of investment, but basically investing in our current economic system, our prevalent economic system right now. There are different models than this, okay, and we will talk about those models later in the future, right? What I want to do is really emphasize how our present system functions when it comes to Wall Street and banking and stuff like this. Okay, so you have to beat the rate of inflation. 5% growth per year is considered to be pretty good if you're investing money, okay, into the markets. So if you're investing at 5%, you're beating the rate of inflation by 3%, right? So you're more than doubling the rate of inflation, which is a good thing. And the averages, I don't believe they're at 5%. And they might be now because we live in a bubble economy. There's tons of flow of money into the markets right now. We'll talk a little bit about that. But if the averages are less than 5%, then you're doing well. If the averages are 4% and you're making 3%, you're still beating the rate of inflation, but you're below the average, then you're losing out in the long run. Okay, in the limit. Now let's look at 10%. And if you're making 10% growth per year, you're doing phenomenal. You're pretty much set. Okay. So if you're making 10% growth per year, after 1 year, you have $110. After 5 years, you have $161. After 20 years, you have $673. After 50 years, you have $11,739. And after 100 years of investing your money, $100 at 10% interest per year, you end up having $1,378,061, but we're just going to put it as 1.3 million, 1.4 million, really, right? The multiple, wow, right? Relative to someone who's getting 5% interest, 1,378,000 divided by 13,150. 5% to 10%, that's double. So you're making double the interest rate, right? At the end of 100 years, you have made 105 times more, or you have 105 times more money than someone who was getting paid 5% interest per year, right? Just because you're making double the interest. Incredible, right? You're beating inflation by 5 times, and the same item, if we assume 2% inflation over an extended period of time for 100 years, if something was costing you $100 a present, 100 years from now, it would cost you $724. You have $1.4 million, right? So instead of buying one item at present, put your money where it pays you 10% interest. You can buy, well, how many? 13,000, 14,000 of the same item relative to this person. Or for someone who's just matching inflation, they can buy one of the items. You could buy 14,000 of them, right? Yeah, 14,000 of them. Incredible, right? And this is something that our present economic system, really huge, is based on, right? That's one reason why when people are trying to go get mortgages, people are trying to go get interest, they haggle over, 1%, 0.25%. They haggle over 0.5%, right? Because when you're taking a mortgage to buy something large, maybe a house, or you're taking money out to invest in a company or whatever it is, right? If you're over an extended period of time, if you're paying a little bit more percent, then over a long period of time, that ends up being a huge amount of money, right? Incredible, incredible. Now, what I want to do, this is in table format, so it doesn't, I mean, it does a nice visual when it comes to the multiples. We can see it, right? Because this multiple from here to here is, what is that? 1,378, 123. So that number divided by this number, divided by 724. 1,900 times, right? 1,900 times from here to here. So if you're just matching inflation compared to someone else who's making 10%, so they're making 8% more than you, right? The difference is 8%. They got 1,900 times more money in 100 years than you do, right? And again, if you consider this over a lifespan of corporations, then as an individual, if you're in conflict with a corporation, if you're trying to compete with a corporation over property, over investments, right, then you have absolutely no chance, no chance. And what you have to appreciate is this situation has been going on for hundreds of years, right? This isn't something new to our present economic system. Well, to a certain degree, it is. In the last 100 years, when the gold standard was taking off, right? But where money has been just flowing into the markets and the devaluation of currencies has been happening across the world, right? But this is something that has been happening for an extended period of time, because we're not just talking about fiat currencies, money, right? We're talking about property as well. We're talking about anything, right? Education, right? The cost of education. This is the model that is flowing or following, right? Education, when I, you know, post-secondary education, university education, when I went to school, was a lot cheaper than what students are paying right now to get an education, right? It's, what is it, over $1 trillion of student debt right now, right? So what I want to do with this data, is put it on a graph, okay? And what we're going to have to do is put this on a linear, we could put it on a log-log graph, but I'm going to put it on a linear log graph, okay? Because the differences here from 100 to 1.4 million is too huge for us to put on a linear scale, okay? So let me erase this part of it, and I'm going to keep those numbers there, okay? Just to show you how this works. Okay. So this is 100 years, right? This part was 100 years. Okay. And this is how much money we have, right? Okay. What we're going to do is put this on a Cartesian coordinate system. And I'm just going to do a simple one right now. And then we're going to erase this and do a bigger graph. So what I mean by a linear log graph, we're going to put our x-axis as time. Right, and we're going to go from 0 to 100 years, right? If we put $0 here, and if we put $100 here, right, we're okay to graph this up for the 2% interest, right? But as soon as we go higher, you know, we can't make this 200, we can't make this 300, because if we do this, we got to go up to 1.4 million. That's huge. We basically have to take it up to a level where, you know, I don't know if you can hear it, there's a plane flying above us right now, right? The graph is going to be gigantic, right? So we can't do that. So what we're going to do is put a log scale on here. We're going to go from 1 to 10 to 100 to 1,000 to 10,000. And what that means, a log scale, is each level segment is a multiple of 10, okay? It's a power of 10. And that is going to allow us to graph our limits on here, okay? So I'm going to erase all this. And what we're going to do is, again, we're still following the same equation, right? So let's put this on a x. I should just make a little bit more room here so we can label it. Okay. Let's bring it here. And let's take this over. Right. So our x-axis is going to be time, right? And we're going to go from 0 to 100 years, okay? And as the video we did before, you know, breaking a line into pieces, this is even, so I'm gonna break this here. I hope that's in the middle. That's 50, okay? This becomes 25, but I want it to be 5 ticks here, so 25 here, so this is 20. 30, so 10, I should leave more space here, right. Let's do this, so that's going to be 25, so that's 20, so that's 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, right, and then 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, okay, so we have 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, 80, 90, 100, right? On our y-axis here, we're going to put money, right? And We're not going to go from zero because you can't take a log of zero. We talked a little bit about this in a previous ASMR video where we're trying to visualize exponential and logarithmic functions, which is basically what this is, right? This is an exponential function, right? So we're doing an exponential function on a log graph. So we're sort of layering logs and exponentials together, right? So we can't take log of zero. So we have to start this at one. And then we're going to go up by multiples of 10. So this is going to be 10. Our next tick, if we do the same amount here, our next tick is going to be 100. And just to save us room, I'm not going to put down 100. I'm going to put 10 to the power of 2. That basically means 100. I'm going to go up one more. 10 to the power of 3 is 1,000. 10 to the power of 4 is 10,000. 10 to the power of 5 is 100,000. 10 to the power of 6 is 1,000,000. And 10 to the power of 7 is 10 million, right? Okay. So let's put our lines on here. Like that. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to put the rate of inflation, the 2% growth rate in red. Okay, so we see where we end up going. So we're starting off, we're all starting off at $100, right? We're all starting off here, no matter what your growth rate is, right? And at the end of 1 year, we're here. End of 1 year, we got $102, which is basically almost exactly where it is, right? At the end of 5 years, we got $110, okay? And the way, I should explain this, I guess, the way the logarithmic graph works, let's assume we're taking this segment here. Actually, let's go from 10 to 1,000, okay? So I'm just going to take this and I'm going to show it to you, and then we're going to erase it, okay? So if this is 10, here's our line, right? If this is 10, here's 100, and here's 1,000. The way it works is 50 is not in the middle, right? That's 10 to 100, but 50 is not in the middle because we're not dividing this up evenly. What happens is from 10 to 20, we get a fair chunk here. And then to 30, it's a smaller segment, goes up to 30. 50 ends up being about 65% of the way up, 60-70% of the way up. So this mark here becomes 50, right? Same with this. 500 is not in the middle. 500 is like up here. Okay. So the log scale basically starts off small. If we're going from here to here, right? Starts off small, the increment, or the increment starts off large, and the increments become tighter and tighter until we get to the next segment, and then we start off the same way again. So from here to here would be 200, okay? And then it crunches up, tighter and tighter and tighter, okay? The increments. So we're only going to approximate it. I just want to show you that just so you know how log scales work, right? So at the end of 5 years, we're almost at the same place again, right? 2%, where are we? At the end of 20 years, we're at $149, right? So 20 years, we're at 149. We're about 3/4 of the way up, okay? At the end of 50 years, we're at 269, 50 years. We're not up there, we're here. My bad. At the end of 20 years, we're like 149. So we're like here, right? Haven't gone up too high. At the end of 50 years, we're at 269. So that's 1,000. 269 is going to be like here, right? At the end of 100 years, we're at 724. So we're still below this line. So we're like here, approximately, right? So our graph is pretty much a linear graph going up to 100 years, right? And this is a 2% growth. Okay. Now, let's do the decline for now. Let's do where we're losing 5%. Okay, so you see how that works, because that's a pretty important visual to have as well, right? At the end of 1 year, we're at 95, which is basically, you know, here, same place. At the end of 5 years, we're at 77. So we're like here. At the end of 20 years, we're at $35. So 35 will be around here. At the end of 50 years, we're at $8. So we're like down here. At the end of 100 years, we're at 50 cents, which is basically at zero. Well, we're below one, right? So we're here, like. So this is what the graph of losing capital looks like, right? And this is negative 5%. Okay. I hope that's clear, that if you're not, if you're losing a certain percent every year, in the limit, in the long run, you're out. It's done, right? Let's do 5% in blue. Okay. So if we're going to graph the 5%, at the end of 1 year, we're at 105, which is basically the same thing. We're here, right? At the end of 5 years, we're 128, which again is, you know, here, pretty close. At the end of 20 years, we're at 265. So right now we're doing a little bit of breakaway, right? Very little. This is a small gap. This is logarithmic, right? At the end of 50 years, we're at 1,147. So that's 1,000. So there's a definite breakout there. Okay. At the end of 100 years, we're at 13,000. 150, so at 13,000, so there's 10,000, 13,000 is just going to be up there, okay? So this is what it's going to look like. Now these would be a little bit smoother, there wouldn't be curves going up and down like this, but my ability to draw graphs approximately is not the best. Okay, so this guy goes basically like this. Okay, that's a little bit better. So this is at 5% growth. Okay, and this number here is 13,150, right here. This number here, the red, was the inflation was $724, right? And that one we're not even going to bother writing down because it was 50 cents. Right? Let's do the 10% growth. Let's do the 10% growth in orange, purple. Let's see. Is purple distinctive from that guy? Is it? Or should we do orange? Oh, I like orange better. Right? Or is that too much like red? Let's do purple. Let's do purple. Okay. So 10% growth. 10% growth. At the end of 1 year, we're still here, basically. $110. At the end of 1 year, at the end of 5 years, we're 161. So we're still pretty close here. At the end of 20 years, we're at 673. 673. So there's a definite breakout there. Okay. At the end of 50 years, we're at 11,739. So if that's here, we're here. This line, the blue line, should be a little bit lower, I think. That was at the end of 50 years. And at the end of 100 years, we're at 1.4 million, basically. So we're up here. That's 1 million. So if we go across, 1.3. So we're a little bit higher as well, right? So we're here. And this is at 10% growth, right? And the number there is 1,378,000. And this graph that you're seeing, these gaps, if you haven't got a really good appreciation for logarithmic scale, which is what pH for chemistry, pH scale is like, what the Richter scale is like, right? This gap here is enormous, is huge, okay? And this is sort of the whole concept of compound growth. And the whole principle, what differential accumulation is based on, the model that Jonathan Nitzan and Shimshon Beschler have introduced, which is basically saying that if you're not, you as an individual, you as a corporation, you as a state, you as a country, right? Because this doesn't just apply to us as on an individual basis. This applies in our economic system right now. And us as individuals, small companies, huge corporations, conglomerates, and even countries have to follow this model, right? Or are forced to follow this model if they're gonna follow some of the measures presented in the way we gauge the health of an investment or a country, right? Whether it be GDP, CPI, may it be for the stock market, may it be PE, ROE, whatever it might be, right? Their growth rate and stuff like this. Differential accumulation states this: if you're not beating the averages, then in the limit, this is what happens to you, right? Because if we take this, the rate of inflation, someone who's just matching the rate of inflation relative to someone who's making 10% growth, right? Then this money here, these funds here are nothing compared to this, right? Because this person here, this individual here, this organization here can afford to buy out this person 19,000 times over, right? Because that was a multiple, that was a difference that we had, right? I believe so anyway. What is that? With 1,302,3 divided by 724? Yeah, 19,000 times over. So even though they would have started at the same amount, at $100, over a 100-year period, 100 years ago, then in 100 years, this person, their net worth, the amount of capital, right, they've accumulated. And in differential accumulation, capital is considered to be power, right? So the amount of power that the purple person has accumulated relative to the red person is 19,000 times more, right? And this is an incredibly important sort of concept to appreciate regarding our growth rate exponential functions, is because even though us as individuals have a certain lifespan, they're way less than 100, you know, 70 years, 80 years, our work lifespan or investment lifespan are even shorter, then if we're comparing us as individuals to organizations that have a longer lifespan than us, much longer lifespan than us, then in the limit, they own everything, right? They have all the power, which is, if you want an example, one of the places this is happening, that has been happening in the last 30 years or so, is in Japan, right? Japan had some serious economic downturns in the late 1980s, and they haven't really been able to come out of that, right? And what's happened right now at present, I forget what the numbers are, but the Japanese government owns a huge chunk of most of the corporations in Japan, right? And what's going to happen if you extend this, not even to the limit, like if you extend this a couple of decades, two or three decades from now, then the government of Japan will own everything, right? So in Japan, the perception that there are different companies that are not linked together, they're individuals, right? They're distinct companies, is going to completely disappear in a couple of decades, 2 or 3 decades. I haven't done the mathematics for it, but right now it's more than 20%, more than 20, 30%. I think might be less than 50%. Let's assume it's 20%. They own 20% of all the corporations, right? It's because they keep on printing money and buying their stock of these companies. They're investing in these companies because they've been printing money off the yin yang. So in the limit, they basically end up owning everything, right? All the corporations in Japan. And that model is sort of relevant to Canada and the United States and Europe as well to a certain degree, but in large part the United States, because what's happened in the last few years is there's been a huge influx of funds, right? With the interest rates being really low, then what banks have been doing is investing that money into corporations and investing that money into markets that are paying them more than what they're getting, what they're borrowing the money at, right? So incredibly important. Why didn't I show you one more thing? I printed off some graphs, and I want to sort of make sure that this is you appreciate that this is not just on an individual basis or just related to the stock market or you buying a home or doing an investment in a property or whatever it might be. This is related across the board. This applies across the board, right? So keep this graph in mind, right? Very important graph, right? And keep this number in line, the 2% inflation rate, which is what the base inflation rate that most Western countries are shooting for, right? Now, the way the money is created, the way the money is generated is, you can look into it. We're not gonna really go into it. It's basically the rate of interest that me and you, individuals, that is set within a country, within United States, let's say, is set by the Federal Reserve. And Federal Reserve is a private company, right? It's not government controlled. The government doesn't, who we elect into government has no say in what the Federal Reserve does, right? So the Federal Reserve really sets the monetary policy for a company. The central bank sets the monetary policy for a country, right? And depending on the country you're in, for most Western countries, our elected leaders have no say in that monetary policy, right? So this is the graph of the Fed's funds rate from 1952 to 2000 and to present right now, right? On this side, we're in 1952. In the middle, we're in the 1980s. I don't know if you weren't around the 1980s, it was insane. The Fed's fund rate, I think it peaked at 18, the 19%. So the money that banks could borrow from the Federal Reserve were at 19%. And on top of that, if you wanted to borrow money as an individual, you had to go to the bank and they would tag on an extra whatever percent on the Fed's funds rate and they would lend it to you. So if you were borrowing money way back then in the mid-1980s, right, or early 1980s, you were paying ridiculous amount of interest, right? You compare it to now and it's mind-boggling, right? And right now where we are, we're on this side of the graph, right? We're basically the Fed's funds rate is basically at zero, right? It's sitting at like 0.25% or something, right? So let's erase this. Okay, keep this graph in mind. Okay, let's erase this. So the Fed's funds rate looks like this. This is time, right? This is 1952. Let's say 1950 to 2016, right? In here, we're going to go 0% and we're going to take it up to 20%, right? Here's 10%, here's 5%. And this is now a linear scale, it's not logarithmic, so all the increments are the same, right? And this is 15%. Okay. If we go, where does it look like? So the middle is a little skewed, but basically started off, you know, the graph, let's do this in red. Okay. So the interest rates look like this. Basically, it's a semi-normal distribution. Went up in the 1980s, huge, and it's come down to, when is it? In 2008, or basically just went down, right? Flatlined, in essence, right? So this is the Fed's funds rate where money lenders could borrow money at, right? And then we ended up paying a lot higher percent, right? So for example, if you were borrowing money at prime plus one or something like this, whatever the prime rate was, plus 1% or whatever, and that means you had an immaculate, you know, if you're doing that, you have an immaculate, history, right? A credit score or whatever you want to think about it. But we ended up paying a higher percent, right? And this graph is, you know, let's call this banks. And this is us, right? Us, me and you, right? So the banks would borrow money, and then their business is to lend money. So they would tag on a certain percentage and lend you money, and that difference would be their profit, right? Or there would be their revenue, their profit would be whatever, minus their operating costs and stuff like this, right? Right now we're sitting at basically 0.25%, 0%, some places, you know, there's negative interest rates coming up, which is devaluing your money. If you looked at the negative growth rate, that's what's really going on in certain parts of the world. There's negative interest rates, right? So just imagine what would happen here if this gap between what the banks were getting money and what we were getting money was getting bigger and bigger, right? Then that means there's more revenue, more profits for the banks, right? And we end up paying a lot more. And in the limit, the banks, if they're making the profit, if they're basing on profit, they're making a lot more money than me and you could ever make because their gap is huge, right? They're getting the money at a much lower rate than we are. So they're paying a lot less interest, right? So what's happened right now is the banks are basically getting money for nothing, right? The money lenders are getting money for nothing. And what they're doing is they're parking their money in places where they're getting paid a little bit more, some of it, and some of it they're putting into huge types of derivatives, putting into crazy markets. And what that's doing is increasing the profits that they're getting multiple fold, right? And what's happening is sort of related to the previous video that we did with mergers and acquisitions and disruptive innovation, right? Which connects up into differential accumulation and stuff like this, right? With these banks, if our present economic system is addicted to growth, and it is addicted to growth, right? It's all based on growth, growth, growth. If they're based on growth and interest rates are sitting at 0%, and there's a sort of a pyramid scheme where everything was based on growth, so people who have invested in the past are expecting that growth, then what's happening right now is because there's so much money out there, so much money has been printed or, you know, typed into existence, right? That money has to go into play. And what's happening is there are different types of financial instruments being created, you know, short-term form being derivatives, that are basically turning our present economic system into casino capitalism, right? Which is a huge, huge problem for us, especially if you consider the previous graph, where if as an individual, you were making 5%, and let's say banks or money lenders or large institutions were making 10%, then what we have relative to what they have is nothing. It's chump change, right? And that's sort of the concept of differential accumulation. And one more thing I wanted to sort of lay out there, which is really, really important to appreciate, right? Especially when it's related to our political system and how our economic system works, right? If, let's do another graph here. Let's just do one more simple graph, right? Let's call this time again. And this, let's call this interest or rate, right? Interest rate, rate in percent. Okay, let's go 0 to 20% again, right? Here's 10%, here's 5%, and here's 15%, right? Now, the rate of interest that an individual can borrow money at is based on your credit score, your credit history, right? If you've borrowed money and you've paid that back, right? If you've invested money, how much capital you have. So it's really based on how you've performed financially in the past, right? It sort of looks back at your history and decides, you know, if you've been a good person, right, good citizen, then you go to a money lender and you tell them, oh, look, you've been in the markets for 20 years, right? Let's call this 0 to 20 years or something, right? You've been in the markets for 20 years, so you can get interest, you can get a low interest rate, right? If you've been good, you can get an interest rate, you know, fairly low, right? If you, that was one of the places where you can get really cheap interest rates on borrowing money to buy something would be car loans, right? And car loans are sort of, where we are, where the housing market was at in the 2000s, right? There's a lot of people borrowing the subprime rates where the interest rates are going to go up and stuff like this. But we'll forget about the technicalities of that, right? Let's assume you can get interest rate at 2%, right? Or 2.5%, right? So you're paying this interest rate, right? Over time, the odds are that's going to go up. Okay. That's based on you having good credit, if you have good credit, right? Banks right now are getting money, and money lenders and even large corporations, because when you're borrowing money, I'm not sure if some of the stuff, I haven't bought a new car for a long time, I'm not sure if you're borrowing the money. I don't think you're borrowing it from the car company themselves. I think you're borrowing it from a subsidiary of the car company. But they're basically getting their money at very low rates, right? At 0.5%, right? 0.5%. So if a company's money lender is getting their money at 0.5%, right? And they're lending it to you at 2% or 2.5%, they're making 2% interest on that loan, right? Which is not bad. That's the rate of inflation. They're matching the rate of inflation, right? And if the way you're borrowing money is based on your credit history, and if you've got bad credit, then, or if you're borrowing from credit cards, which is a nasty thing to do, then you're paying 10%, 15%. Some places, I think they're paying like 18% interest, right? 18%, 15%, 10%. So this 2%, even if their interest rate doubles, right, to 5%, they're way ahead of the game compared to these people, right? And if you extend this to the limit, if you're constantly carrying balance over on your credit cards and constantly paying interest, in the limit, the graph, in one of the previous graph we did with the log scale, 5% loss of $100, it dropped down fairly quickly, right? It went down to, you know, $100 became $35 in 20 years, right? But if you're paying 10%, you're losing 10%, 15, 18%, that's what you're paying, then your money basically just drops down, right? You're done for, right? And all of this is based on your credit history. Now, in the politics video, that sort of kicked off this economic stuff. I mentioned that our present economic system is rigged. It's a scam, right? And here's one reason that's the case. If the rate of interest that you're paying is based on your credit history, right? Then what the money lenders, the banks, are paying should not be 0.5% or 0.25%. This should be way up here. This should be paying the most highest interest rates possible from the Federal Reserve, from the central bank, because they brought on the largest economic collapse we've ever seen in our present civilization, really, in the present economic system, in the 2000s building up to 2008 economic downturn, right? They were caught robo-signing mortgages. They were caught fixing LIBOR rate, is the interest rate that people borrow money at, right? They were caught straight out scamming people. They lied. They sold instruments that they rated the credit agency. They paid off credit agency to rate their instruments at AAA, but they were junk, right? They collapsed, right? And in that 2008 downturn, hundreds of thousands of people, millions of people lost all their savings, right? They became bankrupt, right? So our money lenders, our banks, have some of the worst credit history ever, right? And if you're borrowing money, if me and you as individuals are set to the standard that we have to borrow money based on credit history and what we've done in the past and how well we've behaved, right? Then the banks should be held up to the same standard, but they're not. Right. What they're able to do is borrow money at basically zero interest rate. They've actually been given the power to print money or create money out of thin air, right? So they're creating money and lending it to us at 5%, 10%, 15%, 18%. And they're banking the difference. And if you consider the other graph, the log scale graph, right? If they're making this much interest, right, on what they're lending out, then their logarithmic scale goes up like this, right? And in the limit, they end up owning everything. And that is a major problem. Okay. That, for anyone that's looked at the present situation, there's only one place that leads to. Okay. Gives only a certain select people complete control over everything within our society. Right. And that is a huge problem. And that is the concept of differential accumulation. Because if money lenders are able to compete, are able to acquire money and lend it out to people at a higher interest rate than they are getting, right? Even though their credit history is worse than any other human being on this planet or any other institution on this planet, right? They pulled scams that were into the trillions of dollars, right? Huge. So if that's the case, then our current economic system is a fast-moving freight train heading towards a wall, right? And the outcome, you know, we've never been here, as far as I know, in our civilization. We're not sure how it's going to play out, right? There's the concept of jubilees where all debt is forgiven at a certain point, but that concept becomes irrelevant once the money lenders own everything, right? So if institutions, certain institutions or governments end up owning everything, then wiping out that debt is irrelevant because they own everything, right? And they're keep competing against individuals for property, for investments, right? And, you know, that's sort of where we are in our present economic system. And again, I'll mention this again. This goes beyond just on an individual basis. This goes beyond a certain market, may it be finance, may it be real estate, may it be education, because everything's been commoditized. Basically, everything is a market. One of the most recent bonds, the derivatives that have been being packaged and sold to people, you know, they've gone beyond mortgages. Obviously, the mortgages were one of the causes of the 2008 collapse, but it was beyond that, right? More than that, right? But one of the packages now that they're putting out, because this model, the way we are right now, is an addiction to growth, right? So money is being created out of thin air, and that money has to go into play, right? It has to go into play to generate more money. And because the money lenders and all these people generating money and those who have been accumulating at a higher rate than others for an extended period of time, they have a lot of money to put into play. Then what's happening right now, we're running out of instruments for people to put money in, right? The real estate markets are overextended in a bubble. The stock markets are in a bubble. And they could go higher, right? And you never know when a bubble burns, right? It could double, it could triple over next few years, or it could completely collapse, right? But one of the instruments that just blew me away when I heard about it was money lenders, people who are looking for places to invest their money, are so desperate. They've gone to, I believe it was Verizon, and gotten Verizon to create an instrument, and I think they raised $1.5 billion by these bonds they put out, and the bonds were based on cell phone bills, right? So they took everybody's cell phone bills that they're collecting over, you know, their monthly bills, and they packaged that up into an instrument, and they offered that as a bond, right? I don't know the nitty-gritties of all of it. And they raised $1.2 billion or $1.5 billion with that, right? So all of a sudden, all that money went in, and they're guaranteed, that money that went into that bond is guaranteed a certain percent. I don't know what the percent was on it. It's irrelevant right now, right? So there's a lot of money being created and a lot of money looking for different interest rates to get into, right? And if you're getting the interest rate, you're okay. You're beating the averages, differential accumulation. You have to beat the averages, because if you don't beat the averages over time, you're worth nothing, right? You lose capital, you lose all power, right? So that's one place where the bubbles are being created. And the last thing I want to mention with this is, this connects up to geopolitics. This is huge in geopolitics. This is one of the main driving factors for foreign policy, okay? And I printed off some more charts here. Before the 2008 collapse, the Federal Reserve stopped reporting M3, and this is the chart of the money flow. They stopped reporting the M3, which is basically the quick money that was available, because there was so much money being generated. And there's a few graphs that we could go into discussion here, but one of the things I want to point out is This connects directly into foreign policy, how governments behave, because these growth rates are not just based on an individual basis or corporate basis, they're based on countries. And one thing that has happened in the last 30 years or so, Asia, China has been growing at anywhere between, sometimes was growing at 10%, anywhere between, you know, 6, 7 to 10%. So 8% growth, constant 8% growth over 30 years, right? And we looked at that. Right. We looked at 5% and 10%, and we saw what the graph of that looks like. And if you do, you know, there's Google data available, and you can look at GDP growth, and it just printed this off, right? The top two lines, these guys, are China and South Asia. That's their growth rate. And let me put on my glasses here. So this is up to 2014, okay? And China on average has been growing, you know, if I do an approximation, is around 8 or 9% per year since 1980, right? And South Asia just, you know, recently did a breakout in 2000s, 2002, and they're growing at around, what is that, around 7%. China is around 7% now as well. The bottom countries here that I printed off, okay, the next highest one is United Kingdom. The world, so United Kingdom has been growing around 3% in 2014. The world average was around 2.5. Canada was around 2.5. United States was around 2.5. Belgium was less than 2%. France was almost 0%. Japan is negative growth, and Italy was negative growth in 2014 and a couple of years before that as well, right? So if you take a look at the graph, the log graph that we did, and you consider that Italy was growing at negative percent and China was growing at 8%, right? Then you can see what's happening, right? Where the power is going. And China is not the only place where we're seeing this type of growth. Africa is as well, okay? And Africa is huge. It's going to be, it is a major player. It is going to continue to become a major player, which is one of the reasons why the United States foreign policy, Pentagon basically broke off a new section in their strategic command, I guess, and they created Africa Central Command, okay? And if you're interested to connect this into politics, because I don't want to really go too deep into politics on this, I just wanted to link it up with the politics video that we put out. But if you want a little bit of further reading on this, of how differential accumulation, right? Accumulation of capital, accumulation of power, right? And how that is related to beating the averages, right? Comes into geopolitics, how that comes into play. I put out an article, I didn't print off the date on this, I forget when I wrote this. It was a few years ago. It was part three of a series I did regarding Africa, because it became obvious that things are changing a lot, right? And countries are chasing growth and their and preservation of wealth and preservation of their currency, right? That comes into petrodollar and gold standards and Bitcoin and a lot of different currencies and stuff at play right now, how economics works. But one of the places that a lot of this is getting a lot of action is Africa. And the main article I titled it, "The Future of Africa Looks Bleak. Here is why." Okay. And I'll link to the third part of that series that I put together. And I titled it Recolonization of Africa, a symptom of our addiction to growth, differential accumulation, why GDP growth rates influence foreign policy. Okay. That's a pretty heavy-duty title, I guess. But I'll link it up in the description of this video. And if you want to see how this differential accumulation, how these growth rates, how these charts play out with foreign policy and what's going on in the world and where conflicts are occurring and where countries are going and making business decisions, you can read that article. And I do provide charts to the growth rates and embedded in the article. I've linked up the charts for the Google data of the different GDPs, and there's some other charts that's just from the US government, just pulling the stuff out. Some data you can look at that's on that article, and you could see where that leads into the limit. Okay. I hope you enjoyed this. It's pretty important. I try to put in a lot of ideas together for this and present it in a coherent way. And I hope it was a good flow to it, that the visuals all made sense and gives you a pretty good idea of how things are playing out. Where we go with ASMR math and economics after that, I'm not 100% sure. I haven't made up my mind. We could go down any of these avenues, any of these charts, graphs. I may go down and look at some of the indicators, maybe country specific, GDP, CPI, or whatever it might be. I might go into the stock market and look at some of the indicators there, some of the terminology used there and what they mean, what they represent. Or we may come up and just do some personal finance that I really want to do, actually. So I'm leaning towards that, to do some personal finance, because I'm not really interested in how the game is played on a geopolitics level or on a corporate level when it comes to the stock market or Wall Street, because it's not things that I'm involved in anymore, right? I've lost interest. I'm more interested in different models that are more localized, communal, right? Corporate, cooperative models, not corporate models, cooperative models, and personal finance. So I might go towards that. And at some point, most definitely, when I made the comic book videos, I mentioned that at some point we're going to be looking at the economics of comics, investing in comics, publishing comics, or what may come of that, right? And I believe going into personal finance and linking that with the comic books will work out nicely, because it's a lot of the indicators that we can create for that are also relevant on a personal level when it comes to personal finance, and what type of decisions we need to make on an individual basis to make sure that we're not being buried, left behind, based on inflation beating the averages and growth rates and how all that stuff is playing out. And we definitely don't get caught in the bubble once it bursts, right? Because if you're going to be playing that game, you must have an out. You must make sure you have an exit plan, because once it goes, if you get caught in this wake, you're done for. Okay. That's it for now. I'll see you guys in the next video.